Denise Merrill, who is actually making her second tour here in Milford. So Denise, thank you for coming back. She was very well received, and the comments after her last visit were all very, very positive. So we're glad to have Denise back. I thank you for taking the time to come down and speak to us again. The Democratic Majority Leader, Denise Merrill, please join me in welcoming. She's nervous in front of crowds, so she's bringing her friend Barbara.
I don't have to introduce Denise Merrill. Everybody knows what a wonderful person she is, but I, again, want to say thank you in front of everybody. If it wasn't for Denise, I don't think half the people would have understood our budget. And so it's as complicated as it is, but I just want to say that Denise is one of the most caring, most dedicated people that I have ever met. And I don't think we would have a better Secretary of State if she gets elected. And I wish her all the well. Best.
Thank you so much, Barbara. And thank you for sending her to us. She has been a tremendous asset. And your entire delegation, thank you for sending them, because you are the people who send them to us. And I've been in the legislature for 17 years. My name is Denise Merrill, as you just heard. I represent Storrs, Connecticut, home of University of Connecticut, and I'm sure some of your sons and daughters, and maybe some of you have passed through my town. But I have met over the years many, many very wonderful people from Milford, including, of course, the man who put me in the chair as chair of appropriations after I helped him get elected speaker, and that would be your old friend Jim Amon. And of course, my friend Pete Smith and his son Mike. I feel like I know half the room before I even get here. So, and yes, you may remember me. I was the one that came and talked about the ugly budget. And that's what I've been doing for a number of years, as I was chair of appropriations for 4 years in the good times. And I have to say, I'm sort of glad I'm not doing that tonight, because they're still there dealing with all this. And then after that, I had the great honor of having my colleagues in the House elect me as Majority Leader. So I'm only the second woman that's reached a position of leadership in the House, even after all these hundreds of years, so that's something, I guess. And I like to think it's because people see me as someone who works with others. And I put aside my own agenda frequently, I think, for other people. And I'm proud of that. And there's 114 of us in the House, and it's not easy to get 114 people to agree on much of anything, actually, but we've come a long way, and we're doing the best we can in a very tough situation. But now, when I saw what was going on after Chris Dobb did what he did and the various changing around, I saw an opportunity, and I'm moving on, and I'm moving up, and I'm running for Secretary of the State. And I guess a lot of people ask me, why? Why now? Why you? Why do you want to be Secretary of the State? For me, it's actually coming home, because I started my career in politics running a statewide law and citizenship program for kids, kids and teachers. My first love really is education, and I still believe, after all these years, that the highest service anyone can perform in public life is to educate the next generation, and that is what I care about, and that's why I'm running for Secretary of the State, because I think it's a place where my project that I put together so many years ago, that was put together curriculum and all kinds of programs for students throughout the state, was put there. I took my legal expertise and put it to work doing that. I've been a teacher and a lawyer in my very eclectic career. And I actually started as a pianist, a concert pianist, when I was very young. But I took that expertise to use, put it to use all over the state. And I'm sure I encountered some of the students at Milford High School, because we did mock trial competitions and debate programs. I created a debate program for junior high kids. And that's because I think that we are in great danger in this country. And I have to say, I am, as Rich said, feeling a lot better after this last weekend. Because as of last week, I was really talking around the state about how I feel we're in danger of losing our democracy. And I think it is that dramatic. We're living in a very frightening time, at least frightening to me. I think the incivility with which people try to debate the issues has gotten to such an extraordinary level that we can't get anything done anymore. And I think it's critical that we stop the shouting and start learning to talk about how we solve the problems. And that's, I think, what I have to offer for this position. The two things that a Secretary of State's office does is, of course, clean elections. And I will say right now, I am a candidate. I am not exploring. This is the job I want. And I'm very, very committed to the clean elections program. I think it is the most important accomplishment we have made in this state in the last decade. And I think it has changed already the way people behave at the state capitol, because we had 20 new, wonderful new legislators come in just this last term. And they're all new and full of ideas, and they are not beholden to anyone because they came in under clean elections. And they went to the people in their towns and had potluck dinners and got their $5 and $10 and $50 to run for office. And that has made a difference. So I'm very committed to running under the clean elections law. I am working hard to fix the problems that have been identified, and it's now under a constitutional court order. But I think it's critical that we fix that problem, and I think as Secretary of the State, I would be very committed to making sure we have clean elections in this state. You know, we've had clean elections, I think, generally in this state. I don't think we have a problem, and frankly, I'm not all that concerned about getting lots more people registered to vote, because we saw last time 225,000 people registered to vote who had never voted before in this state. And why was that? It wasn't because we hounded them to come register to vote. It's because they wanted to vote, because they were inspired to vote, because they had someone to vote for. And that's what we need in this state. And I will just echo what everybody else said, including, of course, my dear friend Nancy. And she and I have worked on many issues together over the years, certainly on health care issues and everything else. But we need a governor, we need a Democratic governor who can work with the legislature and work with the Secretary of State's office and the Comptroller's office to do the things that this state needs to have done. And to do that, you have to have people who know how to and want to solve problems, not just yell at each other. And I'll tell you, after 17 years, I've watched the tenor of the debate change in this state and in this country, and it's got to stop. And I will do everything I can to make a contribution to bringing civility back to the discourse. And I will do everything I can to encourage young people to come into the system. That's what I've done all my career. I'm really known for mentoring people, particularly women. I was co-president of the Women's Campaign School at Yale, where we did training for young women in particular to come into politics. I've mentored many, many students, particularly from the University of Connecticut. You work with young people all my life. And I think they are the ones that we need to inspire. And so all those young people who came out for the first time to vote, we need to get them back. And the second thing that the Secretary of State's office does now that I think could be done much better is that they are the commercial recording division, which is where companies come, small businesses, every kind of business, to register their company. It is a perfect example of a place where we can make a difference. We have to show as Democrats that we're capable of solving problems. We have to show people we can be accountable for their money. We have to show people that we can be efficient and effective. And when I was chair of appropriations, for example, I instituted something called results-based accountability. It was a way of changing the way we do budgeting. That's what interests me. You know, we have to show that what we're doing is not just counting the tuna fish cans and saying, how many of this did we do this year? We have to show that we're making a difference, that we actually have some goals and we're trying to meet those goals. And one of the things we can do is make it a more business-friendly place. Boy, I'll tell you, I really resonated to what this lady was saying about losing jobs. The only issue we ought to all be talking about in this state is getting jobs back. Because you know, you're not going to have services for the autistic child or the education system or anything else unless we have revenue. And that's why this year I chaired a job growth roundtable, and we identified some things we could do, and one of them was have a place where businesses can come to just intersect with government, because they have to. You know, so when you go to register your business, you should be able to do it online. You should be able to do it efficiently without having to fill out 75 forms in triplicate. I mean, we have to be honest about this. There's still a lot of bureaucracy in government, as there is everywhere else. And so we have to show that we can make a difference and we know how to solve problems. So that's what interests me, is having a more efficient operation. You know, we've been trying for years. I've served 17 years without a Democratic governor. Isn't that amazing? And part of it is we have had, Nancy's absolutely right, no interest from this governor in solving problems or really doing much of anything. And someone asked about why she's so popular. I think it's because she didn't do that much. You know, so you make people mad when you do things sometimes. But maybe that's a good thing. Otherwise, you just stand still, and we can't do that anymore. We can't afford it. I'll just tell you one quick story about my childhood. Everybody's into doing this these days, but I grew up in California, actually, in San Francisco area, and my parents, my grandparents were Irish. They came over here, you know, and went west for opportunity. Actually, my father was born in a mining town in Butte, Montana, because that's where the Irish went for work. But my mother's father lost his job during the Depression. He was a tool and die maker, which was a pretty high-skilled job in those days. But when he lost his job, I grew up listening to a story around our dinner table, myself and my four brothers, about how her family would have starved. And starved is not too strong a word to use if there hadn't been the WPA and those programs to put my grandfather back to work. And all the time we talked about Franklin D. Roosevelt. He was a god in my family because he put my grandfather back to work. And to this day, I think that's why I'm a Democrat, honestly. Because if you ever ask yourself, how did you turn into a Democrat? That was it. And I think the lesson I took from that was that there are times in this country, and it's happened before, where if government doesn't step in and do something, nobody else is going to. And I think we need to remember that right now. We need to remember the power of government to make people's lives better. I really think we can do that. And I've woken up every day of my life since I've been in the legislature trying to make things better for people. And we need more people like that. We have a lot of them already. Some of them are in this room. And we don't go up there for the money, that's for sure. We go up there hoping we can make a difference. So I think I speak for all of us up there when I say that. And I would very much like to make a difference in the Secretary of State's office. I feel like it's going home again for me. I've always wanted to be Secretary of the State, and so I hope you'll support me. It's a great town committee, great group tonight, so thank you for having me.
Question for Denise.
Not a question, it's an endorsement. I tell the whole group here, I'm going to support Denise for Secretary of the State, and I hope that you'll all join me at that time.
I do second that, but Denise actually called. We were talking quite a few weeks ago, and I didn't need any convincing. Work with Denise. She is a great, great individual. She really understands people. She knows how to work with people. And being the Secretary of the State, that's probably one of the most important tools that an individual must have, is working with people. And Denise is great at that. So,
one of the accomplishments that Denise forgot to mention is she's also the first Girl Scout troop leader for the legislators. Believe it or not, we started our own Girl Scout troop in honor of all the women. And I thank you, Denise. It's a first. And I thank you for being our troop leader, too. And you always have my endorsement in anything.
Thank you.
I got
those cookies
set aside.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't know if you mentioned it, but you have another endorsement this morning.
Oh, yeah, I was going to bring that up. Yeah. Your former opponent.
Yes. Representative Jamie Spallone, who's a wonderful guy, he's chair of GAE, and today he did endorse me and withdrew from the race and threw his support to me very strongly, and I appreciate that very much. So,
yes, congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.